my talk is going to be pretty much the opposite of the last gentleman's talk. I have a couple of charts, which may make Silas feel happy, but Lisbon is not charts, pretty soft. I'm not doing a science presentation today. I'm going to ask you to actually think, take your science brain and move it more toward your advocacy, engagement, community engagement, education. Citizen science is what I'll be talking about today. Utilization of citizen science as kind of a vehicle for scientists to engage the community, to be involved in education, to gather some really valid, wonderful science and be able to deliver science through the community and through education, parts of the community. And also, it gives you a chance to have a lot of helpers on board. Folks who do valid science, who can gather a lot of data, do a lot of monitoring, a lot of inventory work, and help you out. So citizen science is anybody who did citizen science here? Is anybody involved with citizen science? Yeah, right? So, nice going. You're doing good. That's really good. We should all be involved with this. We know that the public is scared of science on the whole. We know that the public doesn't get science on the whole. We know that people in the general public don't understand what pure editing is. They don't understand what data gathering is, what data crunching is, what data means. What do you do with all that stuff, all those numbers? So these are really important things that are part of the public that keep us going and keep science going and elevate the conversation, that conversation when it comes to science. As I said, my name is Jeff DePue. A little bit of my background. I was a professor at the University of Louisville for 20 years and taught freshmen through postgraduate individuals, all in research science and field science, field biology, and research and ecology, primarily with weapons and with springs and streams that are spring fed, as well as caves, and the associated species that reside in caves, primarily bats. So I was involved with restoration ecology since 1988, since the Restore the Earth Conference in Berkeley, California. It was a pivotal moment. It was a changing moment in science, in the field of biology and field science. And then I've been involved with citizen science since the beginnings of citizen science with the Technology Education and Research Centers, TERC, was sponsored by MIT, that wanted to gather data across the world and share that data across the world, compare and contrast, utilizing citizens to gather that data. So it was a great idea, but the problem was the dawn of the computer age was just beginning, and communication with other countries was really fragile. I'm a professional weapons scientist. This is mostly what I do, working with anything that's wet. Springs, streams, primarily springs, but also weapons, ciencias, a variety of different weapons that occur in the southwest. These are jewels, literally jewels in our landscape, in our ecoregion, and really must be preserved and protected. I work with the Spring Stewardship Institute in Flagstaff as well. I have a company called Earth Designs, and I primarily work within education, both in botanical gardens at Santa Fe Community College, Leonora Curtin Weapon Preserve, where we're restoring the Sienega, and monitoring that data. It's a big citizen science project. I work with landscape architects in the region, with basically xeriscape style landscaping. And I work with Southwest Regional Schools and community centers in schools as well, primarily taking habitat that's associated with the school or the community center and restoring that habitat from native vegetation, holding back the water and the land through bioretention ponds or ponds that can be used to naturalize or recreate habitat sometimes. So one of the things, this is kind of a, not an outline at all, but some of the things I'll be talking about, I've already covered a few of these things as well. I have a burning theory that education takes place outside of the four walls, and we've encompassed ourselves in four walls with almost every place we go and do, whether it's going from a car to a room, from a room to a building, from a building back home, that we spend too much time inside. You guys probably break that mold completely because we're all restoration ecologists. The general public does not, and therefore they don't really get what's outside the four walls. Again, citizen science helps with that, and our work and research and getting involved with citizen science helps with that immensely. Developing citizen science projects is basically as simple as finding every single factor that you can think of that would support you and your project and getting them on board. Sometimes that involves not emailing and not calling, but going out and visiting and knocking on someone's door and saying hi. I'd like to do a restoration project, or I'd like to monitor your wetland, your springs you have on your property. What do you think about that? I think the public needs to see more of us as scientists. They need to see our face. They need to have us shake their hand. They need to know what we do. Getting all these folks on board is really important. Steps. Creating citizen science projects are not that difficult and not as difficult as you would think. And sometimes you can attach yourself to your research project can attach itself to already existing citizen science projects. And I guess if there's anything to take away from this, it's the validity and the incredible vehicle that citizen science is in making our world a better place, and education, and having people understand what it is that we do, preserving and protecting what you are trying to do, your project, whether it's trying to preserve, protect, and find a home for the Pima pineapple cactus, right? Did I do that? Okay, good, yeah. Incredible cactus, how cool is that? We don't have cactus like that up in northern New Mexico, but I really like them. So, you know, to have a little cactus community that's surrounded by three sets of fences in the middle of a missile base, wherever that was, is astounding. So who knows about it, other than, where are you? The person who did the project, who's doing the project. The public needs to know about that, you know. that's part of what preserves and protects these places. So going through a simple checklist of getting people on board, finding people, getting involved with that project does not necessarily mean that citizen, even though citizen science is all over the world, and there are a lot of So citizen science, in the world of citizen science is everywhere. Citizen Science Association is this really remarkable organization that houses many of these organizations. You can pick out at least one of those, I'm sure that you know. You can't find it on that page, you can find it on that page, I'm sure. As a matter of fact, one of them is the Springs Institute, which has this incredible database of springs in Arizona. Do you guys know about the Springs Institute, Spring Stewardship Institute? These are some education curriculum and citizen science resource books that help with the conversation. And a lot of citizen science books. It's been going on now for a while. So, you know, the tools to create citizen science and create citizen science projects are there. The opportunities for us are just remarkable, whether they're cienegas, whether they're canyons or arroyos. Those are just the sequoias. Those are just the ones that I deal with in my world. There are many, many, many more. And you guys know this because you do this. But getting education involved, schools involved with it, community organizations involved with what you do is really important. I think I'm going to have to next the but it's a really cool idea, postage stamp habitats and migratory way stations that we want to preserve and protect in our landscapes. Research opportunities are just endless for citizens. These are two of them. They're in our curtain and down the membranes in southern New Mexico. More of them dealing with whether they're air retention ponds, vernal ponds, springs, wetlands. These are what I wind up. This is what I wind up doing. Whether they're in the one on the far right is way down in Silver City. It's called Dragonfly Spring. Thank you, and that's part of the Dragonfly. It's down to that spring. Having the community understand that, understand what is there, and how important it is culturally, societally, environmentally, creating systems like that around that really helps. Examples of successful from the Rio Grande water restoration, Sky Island Alliance. Love Sky Island. They're just an incredible organization. Little Grand Ecosystem Restoration, they're just on and on. It's great, successful ones in South Florida. Why is it important? I hit the last 30 seconds, so I'm good. Still, creation of natural areas for biodiversity is incredibly important. Holding on to the biodiversity that we have is essential for us moving forward. It's what you guys are doing. Education, societal, getting students and adults to understand the conversation of science and get outside the four walls. Habitat creation, restoration, research, monitoring, and inventory is just it's huge and a wonderful example of how citizen science can be a really big help to you, as well as have more people involved with how important the work it is that you're doing. If you want to get in touch with me, this is how you can. We're involved with consulting, education, practice, research, community involvement, citizen science, creating and restoring habitats and natural areas. Any questions? Do I have a chance for questions? Any questions? No, I didn't put anybody to sleep.